days after to slip around.
This new style of music had a hard edge to it. Floyd Tillman was one of the early pioneers with the release of Slipping Around, an unsentimental honky-tonk standard that was both open and candid about sexual temptation and infidelity. It wasn't country music's first cheating song, but it was the first that didn't moralize.
What became honky-tonk music was both about new subjects, alienation, drink, pessimism, divorce, infidelity, cheating. It was about different subjects, and it approached it directly. It just came straight at you.
Ernest Tubb was to become the ultimate honky-tonk singer. His 1941 hit, Walking the Floor Over You, became an instant anthem that captured the heart and soul of honky-tonk music.
But you went and left me here with troubles on my mind. I'm walking the floor over you. I can't sleep a wink, that is true. I'm hoping and I'm praying as my heart breaks right in two. Walking the floor over you.
He had a very stinging electric guitar lead, you know, single string, you know, treble turned up all the way. It would almost scald dogs. And that was a total package, you know, of lyric and melody and Ernest's distinctive singing style that really stood out and made him a star.
You left me and you went away.
Country fans want their artists to know what they're going through, to have experienced it. And Ernest was one of the first great ones with that. He owned a honky-tonk, he owned a nightclub, and he lived that life. He had marital troubles with his first wife, Elaine, over his drinking and his womanizing, and so he was living the life that other people living that life were paying nickels to the jukeboxes to hear sung about.
In later years, Hank Williams and Ernest Tubb, seen here together, would become friends, and Hank would borrow heavily from the sound that Ernest Tubb had popularized during the war years.
I'm hoping and I'm praying as my heart breaks right.
But when Ernest Tubb was paving the way, teenage Hank was still coming up through the ranks, honing his craft in the cut and thrust of Alabama beer joints. By 18, Hank had formed the Drifting Cowboys, a fiddle and steel guitar band who would accompany him through to the end. While touring in the South, Hank also met his femme fatale. In 1943, he fell in love with Miss Audrey Shepherd, and a year later, they were married. So began a tempestuous relationship that would be the inspiration for his greatest songs, but one that would ultimately drive Hank down the road to drink and despair. One Saturday morning in 1946, Hank and Audrey boarded a train in Montgomery, Alabama, bound for Nashville. He had an appointment with music publisher Fred Rose.
What Fred did was he takes this raw talent and he shapes it. He edits the songs. He edits them musically, lyrically. He makes it so that it doesn't just appeal to Hank and the woman he's writing to, but to the broad national audience.
I got a feeling called the blue.
Hank scored his first major hit in 1947, but his big breakthrough came 2 years later.
Lovesick Blues kills me to this day. The emotion and the heartbreak was right there in the words and in the way he delivered them. His voice was just moving to me like He had the truth and the heart right in his voice. He sang, he was a soul singer.
I hate to think it all over. I've lost my heart, it seems. I've grown so used to you somehow. Well, I'm nobody's sugar daddy now, and I'm lonesome. I got the lovesick blues.
When they recorded the Lovesick Blues, Fred told Hank, said, that song's out of meter. Got too many bars in it. Said, and you hold that note too long. And Hank said, when I find a note I like, I want to hold on to it as long as I can. You know, just trying to be funny. And Fred said, well, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. That thing's so much out of meter, I'm going to get me a cup of coffee, and when I get back, maybe y'all will have that thing cut. And they did, but it was still out of meter. And so Fred lived with that the rest of his life.
Despite Fred Rose's reservations, Lovesick Blues became country music's biggest hit of 1949. The Grand Ole Opry had heard about Hank's drinking and refused to hire him, but the success of Lovesick Blues made them change their mind.
He said, we're going to start regular on there next Saturday night. And the first night that I played with him was his first night as a regular on the Grand Ole Opry. And everything was uphill from there on. We were right in the thick of it.
Well, why don't you love me like
from the release of Lovesick Blues, the hits came thick and fast. During his brief recording career, Hank Williams would cut nearly 100 songs that would swing from the upbeat highs of Honky Tonk to dark, brooding love laments.
Kissing and a long, long while. We don't get near her first.
Well, he wrote a lot of Oh, my bucket's got a hole in it. My bucket's got a hole in it. My bucket's got a hole in it. And I can't buy no beer. And then he was, goodbye, Joe, we gotta go, me, oh, my. My heart fell at your feet. I can't help it if I'm still in love with you. So he wrote about it all, from the sad to the happy part.
I've got a song here that I'd like to do that's been awful kind to me and the boys. It's bought us quite a few beans and biscuits. This is the best song we've ever had, financially. A little tune called Cold, Cold Heart. I try so hard, my dear, to show that you're my every dream. Yet you're afraid each thing I do, it's just some evil scheme.
Listening to the songs and reading the lyrics and studying his life with Audrey, who was the great love of his life but also the greatest misery, there was such sadness and tragedy between those two people, and it's all documented in the songs. When you hear the pain and the suffering come out in those songs, it's from what happened the night before between Hank and Audrey, and it's just tragic to think about that.
At the time of Cold, Cold Heart's release in February 1951, their relationship was all but over. Audrey and Hank were divorced the following year. But this bitter and pained masterpiece would prove to be one of the greatest country songs ever recorded.
Hank and Audrey loved each other, but it was a strange way of showing it, I guess. I never did really know whether the drinking was because she nagged him or if the nagging was because he drank. You know, it was just one of those one of those things, but that's what usually fired her up.
I can settle down and be doing just fine till I hear an old freight rolling down the line. Then I heard
Hank's system just didn't tolerate alcohol. Many guys could take two or three good stiff drinks and go out and do their show, and no problem. After about four drinks, Hank couldn't hit the floor with his hat and couldn't do his show.
Understand when the Lord made me, he made a rambling man.
Hank represented that lone male, able through song in a country where men, at that time especially, didn't voice their feelings. He's able to take the stage and sing those emotions that macho men don't sing, to sing it on behalf of the men. That kind of performance is a tour de force. That kind of performer comes along rarely.
Hey, you say I hadn't been around. The way I dress is the same thing. Been further under the house, looking for eggs than you've ever been.
Hank's stiffest competition in the early 50s was Lefty Frizzel, born and raised behind an oil well in Texas. He was the one honky-tonk singer who could match Hank's jukebox appeal, nickel for nickel, tear for tear. Lefty sang revealing confessional songs, and his turbulent and reckless private life added an edge of danger to his appeal.
Say, I'll see ya if it don't rain, you're humbugging me. You're humbugging me.
Lefty was a good singer, and he had curly hair, and the girl thought he was cute. And that ain't bad. None of that's bad, is it? But he sold a lot of records to a younger set of women, I would say. They clamored for him kind of like they used to do Elvis, you know, pull at the fringe on his jacket and stuff like that.
In 1947, the 19-year-old Lefty Frizzel was sent to prison for having underage sex with a 14-year-old fan. He'd been married only a year, and racked by guilt, wrote poems to his wife Alice from his jail cell. One of them would later become his first big record.
I love you, I'll prove it in days to come. I swear it's true, darling, you're the only one. I think of you, of the past and all. If you got the money.
Released in 1950, I Love You a Thousand Ways and the flip side, If You've Got the Money, I've Got the Time, became a double-sided smash hit in the country music charts. Within 2 years, he'd go on to register 13 top 10 records.
Well, ain't no use to tarry, so let's start out tomorrow.
More than anything, it was Lefty Frizzel's unique singing style that left an indelible mark on country music. He developed a vocal technique that would inspire countless imitators and generations of singers to come.
I would say that Lefty Frizzel is one of the godfathers of modern country music.